Back in December, Ayaneo released their first desktop computer. Instead of going for the highest end, bespoke hardware they could source, they opted for the decidedly low-end AM01. For most folks, I think it would have been an easy computer to ignore if it weren't for its stylish Apple-inspired design and tempting $200 price tag. Alongside my wife Emily, I've been putting the base AM1 through its paces for the past month or so, and have some thoughts on whether it's even worthwhile to consider. She already did a full video on PC gaming performance and how it could be an excellent machine for a certain niche of PC gamers. Go watch it if you haven't already. In this video, I want to focus specifically on emulation, which I think will be one of the main reasons folks target a machine like the AM1. And I'll tell you up front, it's actually a bit of a mixed bag. As a recap from the previous video, the actual specs for this mini PC are wholly unimpressive by modern standards. The system runs off an AMD 3200U CPU with Vega 3 integrated graphics, paired with a paltry 8GB of RAM and a 256GB M.2 SSD. It's very much what you might expect out of something that only costs $200. The main appeal here is the very nice case design, as well as it being from a known quantity like Ayaneo. A quick Google search shows that there's a variety of other mini PCs on the market, many of which advertise around the same performance for slightly cheaper. Many of them are built by companies who are likely unfamiliar to most folks not watching the lower-end mini PC market carefully, myself included, which gives Ayaneo a slight advantage for folks who have been more familiar with their impressive handhelds over the past few years. So, personally, I've no complaints about the actual specs of the device, given the price, beyond wishing they'd added a microSD card slot and swapped the barrel plug for USB-C power. But it does raise the question of whether what's essentially a 2019 laptop processor can provide enough performance to satisfy folks' emulation needs nowadays. And, well, the answer to that is a resounding sort of. Now, just to get it out of the way up front, this is a perfectly capable machine for the expected litany of systems up to and including PS1 and N64. Using DuckStation, I loaded up a variety of games, pushed the render resolution to 1080p, and the system didn't bat an eye. Playing older systems through RetroArch also feels predictably good, with the biggest hassle being setting up RetroArch. Similarly, handheld systems up to and including PSP and DS run expectedly well. Playing Ratchet and Clank, size matters. I experience no stuttering and PPSSPP, even after pushing the render resolution to 1080p. Likewise, using a combination of Steam Link and DeSmuME, I was able to play dual-screen DS games without a hitch, while using OpenGL to crank up the render resolution quite a bit. For these handhelds and older systems, I have a feeling you'd need to max out render resolutions while tacking on a bunch of mods or background processes to really make the AM1 unusable while outputting at 1080p, which is, overall, where the system's most comfortable at. All of this is important to note because if you're someone currently using a RetroPie streaming stick or old Android TV box for emulation, the AM1's base capabilities for these older consoles will net you a comfortable upgrade for very little money. Add in the fact that it's so compact and can fit in most setups without too much issue, I think it'd be a great option for folks looking at this lower end of emulation while also providing them with a more broadly usable computer and greater access to Windows games in general. Those folks will also be more than grateful for the very solid GameCube and Wii performance. Using Dolphin, I found that I could reliably run GameCube games at full speed while turned up to 3x resolution. I've lost plenty of races in Mario Kart Double Dash at 60 frames per second without seeing any slowdown outside expected moments for this emulator, like the lightning item. Meanwhile, Wii games tend to shift between 2x and 3x, depending on the game. For example, Sonic Colors plays perfectly fine at 3x, 30fps with only the most minor of occasional stutters, but more involved games like Super Smash Bros. Brawl may require lowering resolution just a bit to remain stable. All of which is great for this price and likely to make a ton of folks happy. What's likely to make folks less happy is Wii U and 3DS emulation. Wii U emulation is technically passable, but nothing to buy the system specifically to play. Plenty of games like Yoshi's Woolly World will run at full speed without a hitch and feel fantastic to play on the AM1. Other games like Mario Kart 8 run much slower than expected. Mario Kart in general can't seem to quite reach 60 frames per second on this hardware at native resolutions, which doesn't fare well for the overall experience. To get to full speed, I've actually had to use a community pack to drop resolution down to 480p. So again, it's technically playable, but maybe not ideal. And that's without even talking about the looming specter that is shader compilation. On more performance systems, the stutters that result from compiling shaders are annoying, but often bearable. Unfortunately, the lower performance of the AM1 magnifies this stuttering quite a bit and can result in games freezing for several seconds at a time. For certain games, like Mario Kart, enabling asynchronous compilation can help quite a bit, but that same setting will also completely break other games, so your mileage may vary. Similar problems also seem to crop up while emulating games via Citra. Super Mario 3D Land is typically my go-to game for testing, since it's moderately difficult for a Citra to run well, slows down quite a bit when a system can't quite handle the game, and will experience more severe shader compilation stuttering on lower-end hardware. And all of that is pretty much the case here. Within the first level, the game hitches quite a bit, while feeling a tad bit slower than I'd like overall, even at 1x native resolution. Combined with some other harder to run games not running perfectly well, it's hard to recommend the AM1 specifically for 3DS emulation. However, easier to run games run flawlessly. I've played through a couple levels of New Super Mario Bros. 2 without feeling a single slowdown or processing issue, which, combined with my experience with SIMU, means that there's no harm in AM1 owners giving Wii U and 3DS emulation a shot. Certain games will run just fine. Others will have obvious jank. It's just important for folks not to purchase the AM1, thinking that this will be a cheap device that'll allow them to finally get through their Wii U and 3DS back catalog without putting in some extra work. Likewise, if you were hoping to buy an AM1 to play your PS2 or PS3 library, don't expect the best experience. I've tried a bunch of different PS2 games with PCSX2 and can get none of them to play at full speed for whatever reason. Even with resolution turned all the way down and spending some time in the settings, PS2 emulation just doesn't seem to like the AM1. After doing a bit more reading, poor performance in PCSX2 seems to be relatively common for lower end chips, especially those launched before 2020. I'm not going to pretend to know all the details on how the emulator actually works or why it doesn't like old processors. If you personally know, feel free to let me know down in the comments. I'd actually really be interested in that. But in effect, it does mean that the PS2 emulation on the AM1 is pretty much non-existent unless a software update improves performance or a new emulator launches to target lower-end systems. PS3 emulation, on the other hand, is a bit of an oddity. To be honest, I'd expected RPCS3 to barely run on a system like this, let alone play games well. Yet, I booted the Simpsons game for the first time and it ran full speed at what felt like a steady 30 FPS in the first level. There were some minor graphical and audio glitches, but nothing real deal-breaking and still impressive for my low expectations. Solid performance even continued on to Persona 4 Arena. By dropping the resolution to 480p, I got it to run at just about full speed. In general, if you're looking to play games that are easier to run through RPCS3 and are less visually complex, there's a good chance you might be able to get it to run on the AM1 pretty well. Of course, once the game's complexity ramps up a bit, you'll be lucky to get 20 FPS out of this machine. Infamous, Dark Souls, Little Big Planet, and Sonic and All-Stars Racing Transformed all chugged along at sub 20 FPS during my testing, even when lowering the resolution from 720p to 480p. But considering PS3 emulation tends to be difficult even for higher-end systems, being able to say any games run well is actually quite nice. Unfortunately, those warm feelings are kind of let down a bit by long load times during initial startup for each game. For context, RPCS3 has a tendency to take like 2 to 3 minutes to launch a game for the first time on my more performant systems. You know, that wouldn't be too unexpected here, but the AM1 regularly takes 10 to 20 minutes to load a game. It's honestly kind of a pain and might disincentivize folks from testing a bunch of games to see what actually works. To continue with all this doom and gloom, I did also want to take a moment to point out that all of this emulator testing has been done with AyaSpace closed. On this machine, having AyaSpace active at all slows the entire computer to a crawl during normal use. If it's open on the screen, 100% of the CPU gets taken up and navigation has a lag of several seconds. Meanwhile, if it's minimized to the tray, 70% of the CPU is still consumed and makes system-wide usage a bit of a hassle. As a result, I tend to keep it closed regardless of what I'm doing. Which brings me to the final topic of this video, the competition. For $200, this base model AM1 gets an easy recommendation from me. If you're someone who specifically wants to play lighter Windows games or GameCube era emulation or below, minus PS2 of course, it's a great deal. There are a bunch of other set-top boxes on the market, like the NVIDIA Shield, PSTV, Fire Stick 4K Max, or single board computers like the Raspberry Pi 5, which will undoubtedly be cheaper, but have less flexibility in the games you can actually play on them. The elephant in the room is expansion and the cost of upgrading. Throughout my testing, 8 GB of RAM and 256 GB of storage has been more than enough for the lighter games this base AM1 can handle well, especially when supplemented with my portable SSD that I use to store all my ROMs. I have some spare DDR4 SODIMM RAM sticks lying around and a spare M.2 SSD from a dead laptop that I might throw in the system at some point, but I feel no urgent need to do so. If you feel differently, and 8 GB of RAM and 256 GB of onboard storage aren't enough, be aware that the actual price for the AM1 will be quite a bit higher than the $200 sticker price I've been quoting. Looking online, here in the US, a minimum upgrade to 16 GB of RAM and 512 GB of storage would typically cost you about $60. For $260, Ayaneo will sell you a 3200U AM1 with those expanded specs pre-installed. However, that's also the same price as the barebone 5700U model, which is such a significant performance upgrade that it will, on paper at least, erase all the caveats I've provided about emulation on the AM1 in this video, except for maybe PS3. If you are already intending to invest $60 extra into a machine like this, it's hard for me not to recommend just spending a little bit more to have a much broader, more performant gaming experience. And that's kind of the central problem with a lower-end machine like the 3200U AM1. As a relatively cheap option to play games on a monitor, it's fantastic. For $200, it's hard to find something that performs significantly better while being quite as stylish. Heck, I bought mine on pre-order for only $150 and can't find anything that surpasses it for that price. It's stupidly impressive, being able to have even this level of gaming for less than I paid for a Vita 10 years ago. But the awkwardness of it all is that the 3200U's viable price range is quite narrow, because even $100 more can put you in an entirely different performance tier. Retro handhelds have faced this problem quite a bit over the past couple years, and it's interesting to see the same problem crop up again now that those handheld manufacturers are starting to shift to the desktop space. Which brings me to my final thoughts. As a $200 mini PC, the Ayaneo AM1 is fairly impressive as to how much performance it can pack into a case that makes a Wii look massive. Its ability to run GameCube and Wii games without a hitch, alongside its ability to emulate older systems while providing compatibility with Game Pass and Steam make the AM1 a versatile system that's sure not to disappoint anyone interested in 1080p gaming. As we saw with its PS2, 3DS, Wii U, and PS3 performance, as well as its sluggish implementation of AyaSpace, it's not a perfect device by any stretch. Yet, it could still be a perfect device for anyone already shopping in the lower end of the market who might be eyeing even less performant options for their emulation needs. The only real issue with the base AM1 is that it's constantly sitting in the shadow of the more performant 5700U model. If that model didn't exist, I think this would be a clear win for cheap lower-end gaming. But since it does, I can only really recommend this base model if you're only looking to spend $200 and are satisfied with the specs as is. Still, I'm quite happy with my purchase and think the AM1 will be great to use as a low-powered Windows gaming machine going forward. Those have been my thoughts though. I'd love to know yours. Are you in the market for a lower-end machine like the AM1? Or are you an AM1 owner with personal experiences you'd like to share? Let me know down in the comments. As always, if you found this video helpful or informative, go ahead and click that like button to let me know, and then get subscribed for more gaming tech videos in the future. If you'd like to keep up to date with news on the channel, be sure to check the social media links in the video description, alongside links to support the channel further, and our previous video looking at Game Pass and Steam gaming on the AM1. That's gonna be all for this video though. I appreciate y'all for staying all the way until the end. Really makes a difference. But until next time, catch you later.